Good evening, I'm Christian Esguerra, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. Let's begin by dissecting the news. He sang, he cursed, and cursed even more. That was activist and Professor Walden Bellio at Sunday's vice presidential debate, organized by the Commission on Elections. Bellio was visibly upset by the absence of the survey frontrunners, Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and Sara Duterte, in the debates. Bellio even confronted the COMELEC, saying it should impose stiffer penalties against the two for ignoring the debates. Marcos Jr. supposedly prefers to speak directly to the people on the campaign trail. Sara Duterte, in the meantime, has made it clear, no debates for her throughout the campaign. Now, was it the strategy, or are the candidates simply unwilling or unable to present their and defend their campaign platform before other contenders? To be part of our discussion, send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Joining us tonight on the line is Vice Presidential Candidate Walden Bellio. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us tonight on the program.
Thanks, Christian. I'm sorry that we can't get a clear line, but I'm here in rural Iloilo province, and from the places where I'm at, the signal is not that strong and intermittent.
Okay. No problem, sir. Let's talk about your participation at last night's COMELEC-sponsored vice presidential debate. Of course, this was noticed by those who watched it. You spent a good amount of time basically taking the COMELEC to task for not penalizing the candidates who refused to attend enough. Basically, what triggered you to make use of that platform last night to actually go after the COMELEC and, of course, Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte?
Well, you know, I really felt that it was unfair advantage on the part of Bongbong Marcos and particular last night, Sara Duterte, for the rest of the candidates. Of course, Lito Atienza was, could not do it because of post-surgery. But we were we were debating each other's records. And in the meantime, she was just seeing us slash one another. No? And that I felt that was really quite unfair that she could be exempted and not be part of a process whereby the rest of us were showing our records and our programs to the Filipino people, and you have somebody who is non-transparent and making use of that non-transparency to try to gain an electoral advantage over her opponent.
Why do you think former Senator Bongbong Marcos and Mayor Sara Duterte, the tandem, have refused to attend the debates?
Well, I think that the problem that they really face is they have very weak programs or non-existent programs, things that are thought up, not in a very systematic fashion, but also the record of the Marcoses and the record of the Dutertes, you know, would be, you know, something that would be very hard to defend in public, on their part. So I think they want to continue to have this image of national unity, which is built on amnesia about what has happened both under the Marcos regime as well as the Duterte administration on which Sara is running, the legacy of which Sara is running.
Okay, we've seen how you have performed in the debates and the media forums that you attended. Do you get the sense that in the case of Sara Duterte, she's trying to avoid you?
That's what a lot of people say. But I prefer to think that it's rather than avoiding me, I think she's just not willing to expose her program and her record to the public, because I think she realizes that not just me, but, you know, a lot of the other candidates, of course, you go into a debate researching your opponent's record and program. So that's, I think, more what she's really worried about. And it's not just me that you know that she would be scared of. Some people say that it's me. I'm not. I mean, a lot of people have said it's me, but I don't think so. It's more the possibility of being exposed for being a very weak candidate.
Okay, we know the importance of participating in debates. You and the other candidates have already articulated this. If you are running for a public office, especially the presidency or the vice presidency, you should be brave enough to defend and detail your platform in the presence of other contenders. But from the other perspective, from the perspective of campaign strategy, what is your response to those who are saying that this makes sense for Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte not to expose themselves to possible risks by participating in debates in the presence of people like you, since if you go by the survey numbers, they are the front runners?
Yes. Well, definitely. I mean, tactically speaking, you know, that, you know, perhaps for them, it makes sense. Although I think even tactically, there comes a time when not appearing after consistent prodding and demands by the public becomes a negative thing. And maybe it's in their calculation when it comes to campaign strategy that the benefits of not appearing is still greater than the benefits of appearing. But I think what we're talking about is not campaign strategy, but democracy. And, you know, democracy it is the responsibility of all of those presenting themselves for public office to be able to face the electorate and defend their programs and defend their records. So it's a democratic duty, you know, that I am appealing to, that all of us are appealing to. And in fact, in order to have an informed electorate, the COMELEC has in fact slated this debate precisely in order to really fulfill this duty of fully informing the public about the different candidates and what they stand for. So from the standpoint of democracy, that's where I'm coming from. And that's why my sense and my approach to these people is that they are very undemocratic in the sense that they value non-transparency over transparency, which is one of the key virtues and characteristics of a democratic electorate.
Okay. Now, incidentally, we know that Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos accommodated or presented himself in a television interview with PTB4 with Secretary Martin Andanar and Erwin Tulfo. And that was, we're not sure whether that was live or recorded, but that was shown before the Saturday debate sponsored by the COMELEC. What do you make of that? He was a no-show during the COMELEC debate, but he had time to actually accommodate an interview with these two people on government station.
Yes, I think it was, you know, he's beginning to feel the heat. And that's why, you know, before, you know, the debate that was aired. And it you know, I mean, Andanar and Tulfo are, you know, basically quite sympathetic to the Marcos candidacy. So it was a friendly kind of interaction, which is very different from a debate. Where, you know, people have to really defend themselves, both to the people as well as your rival candidates. So it was probably, I think, a preemptive move to try to diffuse the criticism that he was not appearing in this debate. But as I said, that shows that the heat is on and, you know, the pressures on him are mounting to really appear, to show up in debates. And once that begins to show in the numbers, that might be what would push him to finally appear. So,
but do you think your criticism of Sara Duterte and Bongbong Marcos for not showing up in the debates, do you think this could actually affect their survey numbers? What value do you think
you can get out of this
in the context of the elections?
Yes, I think that, you know, the anger that I showed, you know, and, you know, the, and, you know, the way that this affected, you know, the audience, the national audience, as well as the COMELEC itself, I think that this will have an impact on this. They, as I said, that just added to the heat that they're facing at this point. So we'll see whether, you know, that show of frustration that I had last night, in fact, added more to the heat. It's just that I think they're also following. Their people are also following the responses on social media. And I think that's important to them. Once they feel that there is a critical mass in the social media that's upset or really, you know, are very critical of their non-appearance, then I think that's going to make a difference.
Okay. Now, speaking of the COMELEC, you asked the COMELEC to come up with stiffer penalties against the two for not showing up in the debates. We know that the penalty is that they won't get any access to COMELEC's e-rally page. But what do you think would be a better penalty against those who are not showing up in the debates?
Well,
with no valid reason, COMELEC, right?
The COMELEC already, you know, said in saying that they would be penalized to the e-rally. That means that the COMELEC does agree that it has the legal, you know, capacity to be able to impose a penalty. And my objection is that, yes, okay, I basically am saying that, okay, COMELEC, you already agree that you can impose a penalty, but what you have imposed is very light because the e-rally page is something that not very many people really see. I mean, you're talking about the most hundreds of people that look at that. That's very different from the COMELEC debate where you have 40 different networks nationwide, you know, tuned into it. So so my sense is that the COMELEC could, in fact, impose a stiffer penalty for this. I think you could legally justify, you know, a penalty of disqualification, you know, for
really?
Them not showing up in the debate.
Wait, let me get that clear, Professor Bello. You think, you believe the COMELEC can disqualify Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte simply because they won't show up in the debates?
Yes, what I'm saying is that if the COMELEC already concedes that according to the law, it has the ability to be able to impose a penalty for non-appearance, then certainly the question really is why stop with why stop with a very light penalty, given the importance of democratic exposure, democratic interaction, the need of information for the public, then you could indeed impose a stiffer penalty. Not you know, disqualification is one of them, but certainly, you know, there would be, you know, there are gradations that of penalties that can be imposed. But as far as I'm concerned, I would think, you know, that disqualification should be considered by the COMELEC as an appropriate response to what is really a very grave violation of democratic processes.
Okay, but don't you think that is an overkill and that would be an overreach on the part of the COMELEC? Because we know how important the debates are and we know how important it is for candidates to appear. But why would you go to the extent of disqualifying certain candidates and removing the option from the people, from the electorate, to choose their leaders, even if they don't want to attend debates? I mean, just to be fair to Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte.
Well, the situation is this. You know, they have been approached several times by the COMELEC and by other, you know, people around, you know, the throughout the country, you know, that, you know, they should show up. It's not like, you know, they've just been invited once or twice. It's been consistent over the last 2 months that they should appear. And yet they have decided not to listen to, you know, the demand of the people that they appear in a debate so that people can be informed. So if it will take the penalty of disqualification to, you know, to get them to appear, then why not? I mean, we're really talking about now the essence of democracy being dependent on an informed electorate. And these two are, in fact, preventing the achievement of a really informed electorate. And all the other candidates are, in fact, you know, participating in this process. So I really don't see why disqualification should be a penalty that the imposition of which would, you know, push them to participate in a debate.
Okay. Finally, Professor Walden Bello, this was floated by one vice presidential candidate last night, that given the numbers of Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte, perhaps, according to him, it's time for the other candidates, including yourself, to unite behind a single candidate to defeat Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte. What is your position on that?
Well, I think that was the personal opinion of the candidate. My own sense about this is, you know, that it's a very open process still. You know, I mean, we have quite a number of days before we hit May 9, okay? And things can happen during this process in terms of the process of convincing the public to vote for certain candidates. We have the limitations of surveys. So basically, if you look at what happened in the 2016 election in the United States, all the surveys, you know, had, except, you know, maybe one or two, had said, you know, that Hillary Clinton would win and that she would win by a comfortable margin. So, you know, while I'm not one to say that surveys are wrong, I don't think that key political decisions like deciding whether or not to withdraw should be based on what, you know, the surveys show. As I said, we've already seen, you know, the limitations of surveys.
Okay. Vice Presidential Candidate Walden Bello, thank you very much for joining us tonight on the program, sir.
Okay, thank you very much, too, Christian. Okay, bye-bye. Okay.
Thank you, sir. We're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back.